All right, let's get this started with chapter 3. Turn down my mic still. There's still an echo, and I don't really get why. I don't get why there's an echo. It's weird. Pain. Forget you have to press X. Aside from Satoshi and my other friends who shared the experience with me, there wasn't a soul in this world who believed that Seiko, Suzumoto, Morishige, or Miss Yui ever existed. And this fact was really taking its toll on me, particularly in regards to Seiko.
Daijoubu ka, Naomi?
Thought it froze there for a moment.
Mou heiki.
I flashed the brightest smile I could muster, though I'm not sure, still not sure he entirely bought it. That night, all I could manage to do was stand perfectly still and stare at my desk. I was mumbling something, but I don't even know what. My eyes had glazed over. It was like I was in a trance. Or maybe I just wanted to be. I didn't even realize I'd actually started writing. I was at my desk now, writing words into a notebook. I kept softly repeating her name to myself, over and over again. The word started to sound foreign in my head, but I couldn't stop saying it, almost like I'd forget her if I did. There was no other sound in the room, just the scratching of pencil and paper, and the hushed sound of my voice. Just the word Seiko in all of its forms.
Seiko! Seiko!
My voice was getting firmer each time I said it, more demanding. And my writing was growing more feverish, more intense.
Seiko!
Finally, the pencil broke in half under the strain. I gripped it so hard that it stabbed into my palm. Blood began to drip onto the paper. My head was hanging limply, but the rest of my body had stiffened. If anyone had seen me, I bet I would have been quite a sight. I could feel blood rushing to my head. My whole body quivered. I raised my head from this vigil and realized tears were streaming down my face. My voice was strained, choking back a sentence I'd hoped I'd never say. There were countless pictures of Seiko drawn on my notebook. But in every one of them, her face was blank. I hurled the notebook from my desk. I slammed my hands on the desk with all my might and screamed as loud as my present constitution would allow. I opened up the photo album on my phone. There was this nagging sensation in the back of my head that I'd overlooked something. I was absolutely bawling at this point, My face was a mess. But I had indeed overlooked something. In the bottom right of the screen, there was an icon for image modification. After a few menu selections, I found myself adjusting the picture's brightness. Beep, beep. I kept hitting the button to turn it up higher and higher. And slowly, in the very center of the black void that had replaced Seiko's face, I could see something begin to form. I felt like I was on the verge of an incredible discovery, filled with a new hope I hadn't felt since just before the incident at the Shinozaki estate. There is still room to increase the brightness. There were still countless increments to go before I'd reached the phone's upper limit. I just kept pressing the button over and over. Until finally, in the very center of the would-be face, I could make out an extremely faint pattern that looked like freehand lettering spelling the name Sachi in hiragana. Was that right? Was I certain that's what it said? Instinctively, I placed the phone screen closer to my eye. The limited resolution made this pointless, but I didn't care. It was so close, I was beginning to lose focus, but still it wasn't close enough. I had to make sure that's what it said. I touched it to my forehead as near my eye as it could get. At which point, the letters latched onto my cornea. They literally attached themselves to my eye. They were there. No matter where I looked, I saw them. My vision had gone half white, obscured by the phantom letters. It took only a moment before the pain set in, and it was not an insignificant amount. I collapsed to the ground, hand ineffectually covering my eye. It was absolutely excruciating. That's around when my mom burst through the door. She looked like she was at the end of her rope, like she didn't believe anything was wrong, and I was probably just faking it. She was definitely more annoyed than concerned. With nothing more than a grunt, she grabbed me from behind, pinning my arms so I couldn't hurt myself. I fell backward onto my rear, unable to resist her restraint. My left eye was glazed over with tears and had gone as bloodshot as an eye can get. And right on the cornea, white blister-like bulges were beginning to form, spelling out Sachi. There was no way my mom could ignore or dismiss that. She quickly stepped back in shock. Finally, acknowledgement. Her breathing had quickened, but she didn't say a thing. She just left the room. It was too late. She was gone, halfway across the house by the time I called out. I was sprawled out in the corner of my room like a giant stuffed bear. At some point, I think I lost consciousness, but I'm still not really sure. I'm starting to feel a little less tense. A little more relaxed, I looked up. At the prospect of actually discerning details in my room, my left eye reacted with a sharp, intense shot of pain. My vision was still half white. I could feel the pain with every pulse and every part of my body. It was almost unbearable. And yet, She'd run out of the room in shock, and obviously had been gone for quite some time. As sick as she was of me, I couldn't imagine she'd leave me to suffer without doing anything. I opened my bedroom door and slowly crept downstairs. I could hear sound coming from the kitchen. A very specific, very peculiar sound repeating at regular intervals. I did my best to sneak over to the doorway and peek in undetected. And what I saw was my mom sharpening a kitchen knife with intense focus. I had no idea what she planned to do with it, but an irrational fear washed over me. I slowly and silently sneaked my way over to the front entrance, and I made sure not a peep could be heard from me until I was outside and away from the house.
Kishinuma-kun!
It was a new morning, bright and early. Satoshi called out to me like I was 12 or something. I've been in this old cheap rundown two-story apartment building for a long time now. It may not have been much to look at, but I felt it had a certain charm. Satoshi was cradling his school bag in his arms as he waited for me in front of my room on the ground floor. On mornings when he wasn't waylaid by Yuka, he would always drop by and invite me to walk to school with him. Originally, he was doing it for my own good, as I'd been known to ditch school a lot, and he figured a friendly offer like his might get my attendance up a little. Admittedly, it worked. I finally made my entrance, or my exit, I suppose. And I'm pretty sure Satoshi must have been really confused, as I had on my shoulders one hell of a backpack boasting a full-on survival kit, provisions, the works. Yup, Satoshi was confused, alright. I slowly, carefully lowered the giant backpack to the ground.
いい加減その小学生みたいな呼びかけやめろ。え?ま、いいけどよ。俺はちょっと今から出かけっから。そうそう。山登りだ。悪いけど今日は俺休みってことで頼むわ。くそ。まさか昨日あのまま気を失うとは不覚だった。
I guess I wasn't all that convincing, but even still, I didn't expect Satoshi to see through me so quickly and easily. I stumbled under his glare. It was almost like I'd just been called out by a newborn baby or like a fawn. Dude was way too innocent for his own good. Ayumi's face appeared in the back of my mind.
Damn,
he was on today! God damn it, I'm terrible at this. I covered my mouth, but it was too late. I already confirmed it. I did have a lot of talismans with me. I'd bought them at the convenience store, and didn't exactly pack smartly enough to hide them. I certainly wasn't going to win any awards for stealth.
あるのか?
いや、俺らが脱出するとき見た通りだ。あのまま潰れてるだろうよ。
Satoshi stared deeply into my eyes as if evaluating my answer for any possible deception. This time, it seemed like I'd succeeded in fooling him.
まあ、どの道、もう幸子もいないあの空間には、おまじないも効かないし、行く方法もないけどな。
ああ、俺は今からちょっと天理症のことで調べもんだ。別に危険なことはねえからよ。
そうか。だったらいいんだけどさ。でも、何か行動を起こすなら、一人でするなよ。ナオミにも話す。こういうのは何も言われない方が辛いんだ。
I thought I was in the clear, but Satoshi suddenly got a puzzled look on his face. He reached over to my backpack and pulled out one of the talismans I'd lazily stuck in the front pouch.
こんなもん聞くのか?
He was looking it over like an appraiser or something. Why wouldn't he just leave me alone?
イワシの頭よりはマシだろ。
I yanked the talisman back out of Satoshi's hand and crammed it into the front pocket of my school blazer.
ヨシキ、たまに昔の人みたいなこと言うよな。
せえな。
でもな、今日はまず学校に連れてくぞ。
With this, Satoshi grabbed my sleeve.
あ?なんでだよ。
だってお前、出席日数足りてないだろ。クオン先生が授業前に朝一で歩行って言ってたんだ。小テストで済むってさ。
知らねえよ。ダブローが何しようが、それどころじゃねえ。
そんなにお前が優先するってことは、篠崎も関係あるのか。
わ
Was this guy psychic? He hasn't been wrong all morning.
まあいいや。学校行って聞いてやる。行くぞ。リュックはとりあえず家の中に入れてっと。
Seems Satoshi wasn't going to take no for an answer.
おい、サトシ待てて、わかった。いや、いいんだろう、わけよって。ちょ、だから、手離せって。
サトシ君、岸沼君、おはよう。
おはようございます。
ああ。
たった15分の小テストで単位をつけてあげるんだから、頑張ってよね、岸沼君。
ああ。
様式には説明してあります。
大事な用あんのに来てやったんだ。終わったら速攻帰るからな。
偉いわ。じゃ。教室行きましょう。
ここでいい。テスト持ってきてくれ。
よしき、無茶言うなよ。
マジでそれどころじゃねえんだよ。俺は行かなきゃならねえとこがあんだ。
I stuck my hand into my pocket and took out a mechanical pencil. They're going to force me to do this. I need to shave off every second I could. As I removed the pencil, the talisman I'd shoved in there earlier fell to the ground.
マニアを探し出さねと。篠崎が。
レーグマニア。もしかして三輪愛子さんのことか。
ああ、そうだよ。
篠崎に何かあったのか。まさか本当に天神症。
ああ。
お前、なんでもっと早く言わないんだよ。
お前が聞く耳持たなかったんだろうが、ずるずるずるずる引っ張りやがって。
アイちゃんがどうしたの?天神?
な、いや、なんでも。ん?
アイちゃん?
あれ、そういえば先生って、庭?
うん。今名前の出た庭愛子は、私の妹よ。アイちゃん。
先生、 そのアイコに会いたいんだけどよ。どこに行けば会えるんだ。
この時間ならやっぱり学校かしらね。昨日の夜様子がおかしかったんだけど。
先生、一緒に住んでるの？
ええ。
俺と篠崎に会った後か。様子がおかしかったってどうおかしかったんだよ。他にはねえの？
そうね、思い出してきたわ。何か小さな青い石を2個大事そうに持っていたわ。
それだ。あいつもう一組持ってやがったんだな。だがこれはチャンスだぜ。先生、愛子は今日も確かに学校に行ったのか？
愛ちゃんなら昨日の夜深刻な顔をしてお家を出て行って、朝まで帰ってこなかったわ。朝ごはんを作って待っていたんだけれど、全部私が食べちゃった。
よしき、
先にあの石を一人で使われちまったら篠崎を追う手段がなくなっちまうじゃねえか。
よしき、待てよ。先生ありがとう。ヨシキは後でまた連れてくるからさ。
As Satoshi turned to leave, he caught a glimpse of Nakashima standing on the school roof, on the wrong side of the guardrail, looking tired and worn. There was no spark in her eyes, no awareness. It looked almost as if she were sleepwalking.
Naomi!
I tried to pick myself up and look around, but I could only move my neck. Everything was dark, and the only sound of my surroundings was an unpleasant, vaguely organic noise filling my ears. I felt in some way restrained. As my eyes adjusted to the dim light of the room, I could see that I was blanketed by red flesh. It was as if the floor had come to life.And was absorbing me into its collective. I focused my strength and was finally able to break free from my bindings, bits of red matter flying away from my body as I tore through it to freedom. I was absolutely soaked, however, with a strange viscous fluid, and chunks of meat were clinging fast to my skin and clothes.The blanket of flesh on the ground was now bubbling out a murky red liquid from all the spots I'd torn in my escape, as violently as if a faucet had been turned to full. I was in tears, trying as hard as I could to wipe the viscera from my body. As I watched, however, the chunk I had been trying to shake free from the back of my hand just dissolved away.Aside from the murmurs of the flesh blanket, the room was deathly silent, and lit only by a faint blue glow streaming in from the nearby window. An entity resembling Mayu was charging at me from the depths of the darkness. It was all in my head. A flashback. She wasn't after me now. But she definitely had been. The tears were pouring out of my eyes by this point. I could do nothing to hold them back. I crouched on the floor to gather my thoughts and noticed that my cell phone was lying on the ground beside me. And that wasn't all. A circular design was carved into the floor, perfectly round as if traced by compass, with the fleshy goo I'd been trapped in more or less centered inside. Actually, come to think of it. I checked myself over for injuries. There were none, or at least none caused by an axe. Memory serves, and if the floor plan hasn't changed too much, the infirmary should be right here. Maybe I can catch my breath there for a minute. The hard wooden clops of my footsteps gave way to a softer, squishier series of plops. Taken aback by the sudden change, I looked down, terrified at what I might be walking in. As I feared, whatever it was looked awfully biological. Huge swaths of the floor were coated in what looked like internal organs, moving and swaying and pulsing in a sick rhythm. I raised my foot and found a seaweed-like substance that closely resembled a network of blood vessels stuck to the bottom of my shoe. There's something on the floor. Kiyomi Academy Middle Class 1A, Kazumi Fujishita. Succumb to shock on removal of spine. Catchphrase was, in this world of uninteresting things, let's be interesting. Well, I should leave a candle here. Maybe Misto will see it. Hopefully Misto will see it. I'm out of matches. I wonder if there are any nearby. Thank you. This is blood. And it's fresh. There should be stairs leading to the third floor over that way. So this is initially Mayu's body. Though there's still massive bloodstain here, Mayu Suzumoto's remains are no longer present. Probably because they were able to revive her body completely. Well, almost. The desks have been moved, and the trail continues here. So that monster must have gone upstairs. The door is latticed with human hairs holding it in place. There's no way through. The bloodstains lead here, which means Yuki is most likely inside, along with that axe-wielding giant. If there were a voltage meter attached to me, it would have spiked at that moment. Never before had one person been able to anger me so quickly and so effortlessly. That wasn't exactly an ideal spot to cut off in the conversation. I panicked and tried to call back. I redialed the number over and over again, more times than I could count, but Misto never picked up. I held my hand out in front of me and looked down at my phone. All my attention was on the little glowing screen. My inbox was filled with old emails from Seiko.
の時間はずっと止まってるよ。あんたと一緒じゃないと怖くて一歩踏み出せないよ。
Stretched out beneath my feet, I could see the roof of the connecting corridor on the first floor. So she doesn't realize she's on the roof. Oh, maybe she does. This was a 5-story school building. There'd be no surviving a fall from this height.
Nami!
びっくりした。サトシ、先生。
ナミ！
中島さん！危ない。私が飛び降りるかもって？ごめんね。しないよ、そんなこと。
You pretty much sounded like you were earlier.
驚いたわ。
何をしてたんだ、あんなところで。
よく聖子とさ、この柵越えて、ほら、あの配電機の上に寝転がってたの。だから、ちょっとあの子のことを思い出してたんだ。
勘違いでよかったよ。
中島さん、その目どうしたの？これは昨日の夜。見せてみて。
My cornea was etched with indistinct white dots. To the untrained eye, they probably looked like random blistering. But on closer inspection, one could easily make out that they were actually letters.
呪詛の症状じゃない？
先生、例とか詳しいの？
うちの会社がね、そういうものも扱っているの。昨日の夜、どうしたの？
携帯で画像を見てたら、急に目に文字が貼り付いたみたいになって。
例の写っている画像とかかな？今ある？
I wasn't sure I was ready to show this strange woman a photo of Seiko, who was, by all rights, non-existent in this world. I considered it for a moment, but ultimately decided the risks outweighed any possible reward.
もうありません。
そう。この世のものじゃない存在が写っている画像は、悪い影響を及ぼすから、保存とかしちゃダメよ。
Though it's obvious Miss Kuon didn't intend that as an insult, those of us who'd survived the heavenly host ordeal couldn't help but have our hearts sink at the harshness of the phrase. Instantly, my depression intensified.
これ、目薬よ。それと眼帯。不便でもしばらくつけておくといいね。ただの細菌感染だとすぐ治ってくれるはずだよ。
Satoshi's eyes widened as Miss Kuon pulled all manner of shocking objects from her bag, searching for the eye drops and eye patch she apparently just happened to have on hand. He also seemed transfixed by the company logo emblazoned on the side of the bag, PL Promotions Co. Inc.
ありがとう、先生。中島さん、今日はもう帰った方がいいわ。安静にしていないと。余計なものを取り込んでしまうかもしれない。
Miss Kuon clearly knew more than she was letting on. I was a little taken aback by this whole encounter. The expression on her face was not that of someone playing around, nor that of a teacher, but that of a professional giving a deathly serious prognosis. It reminded me of the look Shinozaki would give whenever she sensed danger.Reading between the lines, it was evident that Miss Kuon's sensitivity to the supernatural was well honed. Satoshi and I were both looking at her somewhat agape, and I think we realized in that moment that this was someone we could trust.
それじゃあ俺、送っていきます。
サトシ君は授業があるでしょ？私が送ってくわ。いい？中島さん。一緒にお家に戻ろう。
どうしたんだ、ナオミ。
嫌なの。うちに帰るのだけは嫌。
ナオミ。
Miss Cohen's eyes moved downward a bit, surveying my body. I wasn't sure what she was doing at first, but then I realized she was observing the state of my uniform. Namely, that it was a mess of wrinkles, as if I hadn't changed out of it for far longer than one would expect.
してきたの？もしかして昨日から？
帰ったら怖いんだもの。薬打たれる。
I probably sounded like a little girl at the doctor's office, frightened of the needle.This may have been the first time Satoshi realized just how much Seiko's loss still bothered me. I was in shock and denial, and I'd been trying so hard to play it off.
わかったわ。じゃあ、うちに行きなさい。お家に連絡だけ入れておくわね。カバン取りに一度教室に寄りましょう。じゃあ、サトシ君、今日も授業、頑張るのよ。
ナミ！よく、休むんだぞ。
うん。
ヨシキは一人で動こうとするし。篠崎も心を痛めていた。ナオミもやはり苦しんでる。このままじゃみんな心が潰れてしまう。なんとかしなくては。ごめん先生。ヨシキ、待ってろ。
This was no time for schoolwork.
きっと、丹羽愛子さんに話を聞くために、東照学園に行ったに違いない。
いいか、水木。お前は特に二人の親友だったから気持ちはわかるが、くれぐれも気を落とすんじゃないぞ。お家の方も捜索願いを出されているし、きっと冴えの木も大上もひょっこり帰ってくる。心配はいらないよ。
はい、清水先生。
As soon as the teacher was out of sight, the girl's eyes narrowed. She stared after him with a look of utter contempt. This had to be Magari Mizuki.
大人ってなんでこうバカなのかしら。
She followed this statement with a sigh that seemed to say, I'm so much better than that person. And then bingo.From her skirt pocket, she withdrew the ever after stones.
気休めで世の中が回るなら、誰も努力なんてしないだろう。
She was coyly playing with the stones as she said this, fitting them together at different angles in her hands.
で、お前誰？
She hadn't turned around. She just somehow seemed to sense my presence. I stepped out from behind the bench into her line of sight.Magari then flashed me the iciest stare I'd ever seen. I'm not usually intimidated by that sort of thing, but even I had to really make a concerted effort not to look away.
Magari ってやつだよな。 他のやつに聞いたんだけどよ、丹羽愛子やあの那穂ってのとも仲が良かったって。その石なんで持ってるんだ。それは今丹羽愛子が持っているはずなんだが。
I figured I might as well just jump in whole hog, though not without bracing myself first. I knew that question couldn't exactly lead me anywhere good. And sure enough, her response was almost immediate.
Korosuzo.
Ah?
Sensoku shitara korosu. Kore wa omae no shiru koto dewa nai. Dakara, dete itte kureru? Bugaisha. Sensei yobu wa yo.
She certainly wasn't messing around. Nonetheless, I'd come too far to back down now. Despite her threats, I knew I had to keep pushing.
ねえ、天神所へ行くのか。俺も連れて行ってくれねえか。
は？
今あそこには俺の仲間が。
Before I could get in another word, a giant scythe literally appeared in her hand out of nowhere, and just like that, I couldn't move a muscle.She had me completely restrained. The blade glinted majestically in the light of the sun. But as I looked up at it, it was her other hand that really did me in. Using the heel of her palm, she flung me backward with an incredible force. There was a loud, sudden metallic sound as my back struck the bench behind me.Her form was unbelievably precise. My momentum caused me to pivot over the backrest and flop down onto the ground below. I became acutely aware of every muscle and every bone in my body as a jolt of intense pain fired through all of them. The wind wasn't just knocked out of me, it was obliterated. I gagged and choked for a while longer.But eventually regained the ability to breathe normally, and with it, my composure. I forced myself up with some effort, but Magari was nowhere to be seen. I was in a complete daze. I'd always thought of myself as being able to hold my own in a fight.This was twice now that I'd been laid out with almost no effort. I have to find a way to open this door.All the trophies displayed in this case have been vandalized with graffiti. Hinata High Class 2-5, Yusuke Ogawa, hanged and stabbed, unclear which offense resulted in death. Okay, nothing much else in there. Outside the window, there was some sort of bizarre statue clearly visible in the pale blue light.
Sensei,
私に力を貸して。きっと生き返らせてあげるからね。おなじみでしょ、私のろうそく。私来たよ。
行かないの。
仕方ない仕方ない。